I'm really excited about the guest that we have on the line, Dre. I've been trying to interview this dude for a minute now. I've been following his movement for a little minute now. And what got me into it was because, Dre, you know, for 3 years, I had a show called The Uncle Tom Show.
Oh, yeah.
Where I shared my views.
It was very popular.
It was very popular, thankfully. But I ended up, you know, abandoning ship on The Uncle Tom Show. Because I got too much hate. And
is that what it officially was?
You know, when I look back at it, yeah, we're living in a society where people are just pussies, and I just couldn't deal with the doxing and the this and the that. And I was
doxing
just,
serious.
Doxing
I
is
never
really
approve of
serious.
Doxing of anybody.
Nah,
nobody.
Nah, doxing is bullshit. But I came across this dude who was carrying the torch.
Okay.
If I should say. Definitely a very intelligent cat. I had a chance to check out some of his videos, and I'm excited to introduce him to Super Audio Network. Ladies and gentlemen, on the line, Mr. Charleston White. What up, man?
How y'all doing, man?
We doing good, man. Doing good out here in California, and you're calling from Fort Worth, Texas, right?
Yeah, Fort Worth, Dallas, Fort Worth area, metropolitan.
Yes. Well, shit, I want to jump into it, man. I want to, you know, maybe later on we'll talk a little bit of the current events and things like that, but I would love to, you know, get to know you first. I understand your uncle was a pimp.
Yeah, man, my Uncle Wayne, which was my mom's oldest brother, when I was born, I think probably about 1976 or early 1977, there was a movie that came out that was called Comeback Charleston Blue. My dad's name is Charles. Mom named me Charleston. So when I come home from the hospital, you know, Unc's lifestyle, he's the only boy amongst three girls, and he's the oldest. And so, you know, that was his favorite movie. He gave me that name, Blue, Charleston Blue. And so it kind of stuck with me throughout life. I grew up under, you know, my first 5, 6, 7 years of life, man. You know, there's a lot of exposure to Uncle Wayne. My mother was a teenage mother. She had my brother at 15, had me at 17. My dad was a square guy, right? He was a square nigga. He went to the Navy, and then he got a job working within government. My mother was a teenage mother with a lot of ambition. And so she landed a job at General Motors in the early 80s, 81, 82.
Oh, the good years.
Yeah, and so our lives kind of went from rags to riches, seemingly like overnight for me because I was so young. But Uncle Wayne was a very pivotal a male figure growing up because he was mom's only brother. My granddad owned a barbershop over on the south side of Fort Worth, over off Allen and Hattie and Betsy. And if anybody from Fort Worth, they know what I'm talking about. And so the name of the barbershop was called Chopping Block. And everybody hustled outside and around that barbershop. And so I was always able to go and sit around other men and see the early hustlers from the late 70s, the early 80s. I got to see the guys who pushed the crack out into the streets. I got to see my granddad also. He worked at the bus barn, which the bus barn, you know, that's the buses for the schools. So he had all the women at the bus barn. You know, he had some selling pussy. He had some boosting clothes. So both my granddad and both my uncle, man, was real good with ladies. My mother is a very a strong black woman who's highly respected in the streets as well. My grandfather is one of the founders and one of the originals of this big. Back then, it was like a social club. It's called the Dappers. And okay. It was a bunch of, you know, dapper gentlemen who dressed real well. And so I come from dapper men. I come from men who pimped. The significance about my uncle was he was what they would call a gorilla pimp. He was very abusive.
Yeah.
He beat women. And so I grew up believing that some of his prostitutes were my aunts. You know how they say that's your auntie, that's your Aunt Sharon. They didn't say that's his hoe, they say that's your auntie. Mm-hmm. So I grew up seeing them as aunts, right? So when I wake up at night, mom got a room for, you know, her big brother. He coming through with trash bags full of money. Mm-hmm. And so I got to see things that most children, you know, shouldn't see early on, Waking up in the middle of the night, man, hearing my uncle jump on who I thought at the time was my Aunt Sharon, and having to go to school 2-3 hours later, seeing her with the black eye. You learn to either become that kind of person, or you learn to defy being that kind of person, man. And so growing up around women, I never wanted to be the one to inflict the pain. So I never vowed to be the one to slap around. And my uncle was vicious, man. He'll beat her in a minute. But it also left a certain fact, a factor of intimidation that I had toward my uncle, where I couldn't, you know, that's a side that prevents you from bonding, man, with your dad or with your uncle, or whomever you see abusing people. And so I saw that growing up, man. And I had an older brother. He nor I never been spanked by a man. We never been disciplined by a man. We always got to see the negative elements. The drunk man, the hustler man, the wife beater, the woman beater, the cheat man. So we never saw the doctors. We never saw the lawyers. We never saw the faithful husbands. I never seen a man get up and go to work. All I ever seen was mom get up and go to work. So growing up in my young and impressionable mind, I didn't know men work because I never seen a man get up and go to work.
Wow. Damn.
Yeah, that's deep, homie. That's deep. You know, I had my mother. She was very loving, very nurturing. She was a woman that had a moral compass, right? So she didn't lie. She taught us to do right because right is the right thing to do. She never condoned our wrongdoings. So she tried to teach us right, but because, you know, man, the negative elements that you see from your culture, your mom's brothers, your mom's cousins, spending the night over your homeboys' houses. So all the negative elements that you get exposed to, and you don't have anything to correct it. You don't have anything to rebut it.
Yeah.
You don't have anything to compare to, right? So you embrace it. When you cut on the television propagates what we see in our homes, right? If we watch a good show on TV, man, we go see a nigga that kick a bitch ass, right? Mm-hmm. We know an uncle that kick a woman. We got homeboys who jump on women, but we don't say anything.
You hear it in gangster rap.
Yeah. So it's propagated in television through imagery, through sight, and then it's solidified through the music. So as a kid, man, you see Uncle Joe, he whoop women. Uncle Wayne, he whoop women. Mom's cousin Jeffrey Naki, they whoop women. You never see a man that's faithful to a woman. So you see what I'm saying? So
yeah, seeing all the negative shit.
Yeah, homie, I get all the negative shit. And so, but mom is trying to teach us this. Boy, where you get this from? Oh, this girl bought it for me. Boy, give it back to her. So you know, mom is saying things like, if you go over a woman's house, this is what mom trying to teach a nigga. If you go over a woman's house and you open her ice box, you've used electricity. If you grab her remote and start flicking the television, punching on buttons with the remote, you using electricity. If you go in there and pee in her bathroom and flush her toilet, you done use some water. So you less than a man, son. If you go over there and you sleeping with that woman, you can't help that woman in those areas.
That's an interesting point of view.
So that's what mom is saying, right? Trying to teach us not to be the type of niggas, for one, to be sovereign, lazy, and to be dependent upon women. On but the flip hand,
you're doing what we you see.
Go ahead.
No, go ahead.
On the flip end, you hearing all the bullshit from the men,
exactly,
from the players, the gigolos, the max, and it's counterproductive to what mom is teaching.
Yeah.
And so as a boy, I'm saying, yeah, mom, I hear what you saying, but I need to identify with a man. I need a man to reiterate what mom is saying. So what mom is saying falls on deaf ears, because I got the man that I see, and then I got the music that I hear, and I got the movies that I watch to make mom say, no, I don't want what mama talking about.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, this life is a little more interesting over here.
Yeah.